Woo! Wow. Damn.
My button's getting old. Hey, everybody. Welcome to The Hang. And wherever you are, let's get rid of that. And I'd like to welcome Steve Orkin and Mr. Gary Meek. They're on the screen as you see them there. And we'd like to welcome all of you that are hanging out. I got to put my comments up so I can see what's happening here. Yeah, some people out there. Cool. All right. Nice to see you all. Steve, how you doing there, man? Where are you at? You're in L.A., right?
I'm in L.A., and I'm going to the game today. Sorry.
Oh, that's okay. That's all right. Good. Yay, Cleveland. Gary, how are you, man?
I'm good, man. How are you? Long time no good. Talk to you.
yeah. Welcome to the hang, man. Welcome. Thank you. So the little thing that I just played right there was the end of a song that we are going to talk about today, written by Mr. Gary Meek. And just a little intro. Gary's one of my favorite musicians on the planet. First heard him back in the early 2000s and invited him to join my band at that point, and we've been friends and made a lot of music ever since. And he just continues to push the envelope, and now he's as good a keyboard player as he is a sax player. So
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I do. But yeah, we're going to get into this tune and talk about it. Steve, would you like to say anything before we get into our discussion here?
Just that you are always saying that Gary is your favorite sax player, so it's very cool to have him on.
Absolutely.
Always absolutely. Saying. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, you're my favorite drummer too, so.
Oh. You guys think I have some money in my pocket. Yeah. Hey, I see some folks there. I see Bob Matheny there. I want to give a shout out to Bob. He's recovering from some surgery, and we hope he's doing well. Bob, we love you and hope you're doing good. And Bob was one of my first teachers ever here in St. Louis, so we're wishing him well on his recovery. And what else? I want to give a big shout out to the Yellow Jackets. I went to see the Yellow Jackets last night with Will Kennedy. Holy cow. If you get a chance to see these guys, please go see them. It's such a treat for the soul. Bob Mincer and Russ Ferrante, Will Kennedy, and Dane. I didn't get his last name, but this guy, this younger guy from Australia, boy, is he great bass player. So we had a nice time hanging out with the Silvermans and Jay Oliver last night to see the Yellow Jackets. Go see them. They're going to be on tour in Europe next month, as will I with Tom Kennedy. We're co-leading a band in Europe, finally going to get out and play and do a tour, so I'm excited about that. I see Lou Joya there. Lou, what's happening? All right, so cool, man. So, you know, this is we're on. We always like to talk and promote my online school, and you know, basically everything that we talk about in the program here is based on kind of educational, but it's all about the music. It's all about, you know, just trying to give some ideas behind what I may do. And Gary is a great teacher and spends a lot of time doing that as well, up in northern central. What do you call that, anyways?
It's the Central Coast.
Central Coast, yeah. So we're going to try to answer some of your questions and you know, get into it. But the whole premise of today's show is kind of talking about preparing and treating a song that is a new song. It was a new song for me at the beginning of the week. It is called Struck by Lightning, and it will be on some upcoming recording, I'm sure. You've got
it's my first track after I just released the Monterey Groove record. So
right, tell us a little bit about what that record is. You've got a record, a new record out.
Yes, we just finished a new record, recorded all, you know, last year during the pandemic, and it was possible. A lot of it was possible because of that, because I had a room that I could use for free to record live drums, and so we did everything, including recording the drums, which was a new adventure for me, man. You know, I had to learn how to do it. I talked to Dave a lot about, you know, how to do it, and I had to learn how to mix and all these kinds of things. So, you know, we did that. A lot of it is revisited older material with kind of a new spin, and Michael Lint, my co-producer and guitar player, did a fantastic job, and Skylar Campbell, the drummer, and of course Dave played on a couple cuts, and he sounds, you know, like Dave. It's amazing. And we got it done, which is pretty amazing, actually, you know, and all remotely, and you can ask Dave, but it sounds pretty damn good. And you know, all the energy is great, the vibe is great, and it's getting very good reviews. I'm very pleased with it.
Yeah, man, there's nothing like you know, having your own project with a bunch of great musicians. Skylar sounds great on the record, as does everybody else, and I had fun playing one tune, and we actually used an older tune that,
yeah, that's right.
that I had recorded a demo many years ago, and we lost the files, and you know,
yeah.
So it was what it was, you know, Move Out, I think it was, right?
Yeah, but it sounds great.
But yeah, what's the name of the record again?
Monterey Groove.
Monterey Groove. Go check it out. Gary Meek, his debut. Well, not a debut. You've had a lot of records out.
Yeah, it's my debut eighth record.
Cool. All right. Concerning the tune, Steve, I guess we'll get into our little discussion here. If you see any questions pop up, you know, please, I'm not able to keep up so well, so just hit us up, and we want to try to answer questions as we go here.
Sounds good. I'm going to make a switcheroo here. We'll see you in a bit.
Okay.
Hey, Steve.
Ciao, Steve. Yeah. All right. Okay, Gary. So this tune, Struck by Lightning. Can you tell us a little bit about this tune? What the situation is with this?
Song? Yeah, this is actually an older tune that has been actually, it was recorded on my very first self-titled CD, and then it's also on one of Ayrton's records, and he actually called the record Struck by Lightning. But it was, at that time, I was very much in the Brazilian scene, and I was into Brazilian music, so the original ones are very sort of like Brazilian influenced, you know, like the chorus, you know, it's got that partido alto feel, you know, and this is more of like a sort of like Rocco Tower of Power funk, you know, thing,
right?
And go ahead.
When I got the chart you sent, I said, send me a chart or something, because I'm listening, you know, I listened to the version one or two times with Skylar on it that you've got recorded, and I didn't want to listen too many times to that because I didn't want to learn what he played and just play that. So I started listening just to the song and what it was saying to me, to, you know, as a artist drummer, to try to create a part. Mm-hmm. And I saw on the part it said, you know, having something to do with you know,
Partido Alto, probably said, yeah.
with the Brazilian thing, and I was like, it's not what the bass part is doing right here. So you haven't heard me play the song yet. You know,
no, I can't wait, man.
So, you know, I'm really curious. What did you have? Because I didn't ask you for it, actually. Mm-hmm. Which I usually do, but sometimes it's kind of nice to not have any preconceived ideas, because then as the drummer, and this is what I always attempt to do for composers and leaders, is give them different ideas of how to approach something. And one thing I'm going to do is just kind of get into how sound, you know, the tuning and all that kind of stuff can affect the vibe of the song. Because right now, the way I have my, and primarily talking about the snare drum, because the snare drum right now is tuned pretty much for my fusion stuff that's cracking pretty good. It's a medium-high pitched drum. It's my brass shell, which is warm anyway, but it's got a crack to it. And most of the time, you know, like in the solo, what I was doing, I was playing a lot of rim shots, which is coming out of the jazz head, and that's the sound that has. But, you know, this tune could go either way. It could go like a contemporary thing, you know, that, you know, and one of my questions always is, what are we doing here as a project for the song? Are we creating something that you want on a smooth jazz radio station, or is it a pop thing in that direction, or are we doing a dialogue jazz fusion, you know, play a bunch of stuff and not a bunch of stuff unnecessarily, but stuff that would, you know, work with the song?
Well, it's definitely the second one.
Oh, it is. It is. Yes. more of the fusion jazz stuff.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. It's, I never think, tell you the truth, Dave, when I'm writing things, I never think of what this is going to do as far as like the public or airplay or anything like that. You know, this last record had a couple, had three tunes that actually work well for smooth jazz radio, but I didn't do that on purpose.
Right.
You know, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's, yeah, I mean, the beauty about what you're doing is your melodies are great and they're catchy, and, you know, so, you know, if the parts, if especially if the drummer, you know, there is some attention that needs to be paid attention to for me anyway, because it can make the difference between, sure, you know, getting radio play, whatever that is these days. But, you know, there's not a lot of, you know, there never has been like a market, you know, for playing hardcore fusion stuff. So my stuff has always kind of slipped through the cracks because it's certainly not smooth and it isn't bebop jazz. So it's kind of like in,
I understand,
this, gray,
man.
In this gray area, you know, but,
I spent a lot of time in there myself.
Yeah. So, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to play the tune kind of, up until the sax solo. And just to give an idea of my take on it in kind of the fusion way, because that's how I got the snare drum tuned right now.
Okay.
And then we'll talk about it, and I'll do it again in a sense of thinking about playing it a little bit more commercial. Let's put it that way, with less of that vibe. Yeah. So let me set up my, go from the beginning here. So Struck by Lightning, we'll just play a little, the first half of it here.
Cool.
Okay.
Wow.
So
yeah.
So yeah, a little, I guess a little bit of different approach than you're used to hearing.
You're playing the hi-hat on the choruses, which actually I really dig.
Yeah.
I think Skyler went to the ride.
Yeah. When I heard the bass part, which is just and what's your bass player's name again?
Dan Robbins.
Man, he sounds great on this. It's a real guy playing that. So it's a very, funky and tower. So, we all tend to go to our influences at times, and especially me, I get into referencing a lot. Mm-hmm. And, when I was hearing that, I could have gone two different ways. I could have gone the Garibaldi approach, right? But I always generally, in something like that, the way that, that Steve Gadd would play those kind of grooves with that consistent 16th mm-hmm. and the offbeat hi-hat, just nailing the time, very consistent. I tend to go into that reference and try to, and of course add my own stuff to it. I just thought it grooved really hard that way. It felt the best to me, to play it in that sense. Mm-hmm.
And you use cross pick in the melody sections too.
Like I said, I know that Skyler didn't approach it that way. His approach was really cool too, because he came up with a cool groove for that section. But what the song was dictating, this is such the cool thing about the individual artist, the individual musician, how they hear the music, and how it's treated, and how you want to treat it to create a vibe, create an emotion, create a feeling. So for me, the snare drum, I didn't hear to play that because it was just too heavy. And so the cross stick kind of, because it was sneaky, it had like this real kind of quieter thing. And the way you were playing was quieter. And Paul Pesco playing that cool guitar part. So I wanted to, vibe that. And then you had some program percussion in there that I could play too. Mm-hmm. Right. So I did the cross stick. Now, one of the things that I tend to get into is really thinking about the hi-hat motion. Okay. Cause I could have done this a couple of different ways, and I'll show you. When we're talking about this type of thing, in my school, especially in the school that I talk about, there's a bunch of lessons and vibes on supporting the music, right? What parts to come up with. And I always tell the students, and people to sing things first, listen to the music without the drums and sing the drum part, what can work. So, mm-hmm. and then it has a lot to do with what's going on in the actual music, right? So at this section, in the A section here, so yeah, so there's, for me, there's two motions that, three actually, that could work. And one of them would just be straight eights, because there's a lot of 16ths going on, but there's also the volume of the hi-hat, and that becomes a really important thing that, you don't want to play this too heavy, mm-hmm. especially when there's other 16ths carrying on the motion, right? So if I played that and I just played eighths on the hi-hat, but I played them heavy, mm-hmm. watch the effect. It's not happening. Right, so just, obviously a heavy eighth note thing, that kind of just was like, doesn't feel right, right? Mm-hmm. So by simply just playing the quarter note accent kind of made all the difference in the world, right? Of just that feel. So that could work, right? It was nice once I started playing it in time. for me, it's kind of, it was difficult to nail it though, because I wasn't in it yet, you know. Mm-hmm. So for me, the I chose to play a 16th note part, and generally speaking, for this, I mean, you could choose three different 16th note parts, right? I could play, straight 16ths and just accent the quarter note. Mm-hmm. Now, for a lot of this stuff, this is where technique becomes a means to an end, because if I don't have the technical ability to pull this off, it's not going to work, right? So it'd be something like this. Right, so there's that approach. Mm-hmm. That can work. And these are the things I like to give, you know, it's like if you and I were sitting in the room, it's like, okay, check all these out. Which one do you like? You know, so I could do this. Another aspect that we'll talk about too. I heard to go to halftime there, because that's what it stated to me, right? But anyway, back to the hi-hat thing. I chose this part this time to go dut 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 dut.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's another alternative, and then yet here's another one. So that was da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Mm-hmm. And that's the one that I actually chose that felt the best to me when I would record it, listen back for my preference. Now, as the composer, do you have a preference? Which one did you like?
To me, it's sort of apples and oranges. Your playing is so good that they both feel really good to me. So I would actually turn to you and say, which one feels the best to you?
Yeah. You know? Well, as a drummer, we appreciate that, because a lot of times the composer's like, no, do this, and they're married to a demo or something that they did in their bedroom, and it's not even drumistic. So sometimes we're forced into a situation to have to play things that, you know, technically it could be challenging and also not in the wheelhouse. So we have to, this is why practicing independence, practicing different combinations of patterns like this that do go back and forth, so that you are, as a drummer, used to playing these different things. Because
I had the advantage of being an absolutely lame drum programmer, so there's nothing.
That doesn't matter for some people. They'll program six hi-hat parts and say, play this. You know,
I usually say, this is not to be, you know, this is not to be played. This is to get me through the demo.
Right. So, yeah, for me, so I tried all those when I was playing it, and I had to go with the one that was most comfortable for me, which ended up being that pattern. Now, again, though, you know, for the drummers, of course, it's how I'm treating that. And again, in the school, I talk a lot about, the treatment of the different voices and the accents. And then some of this gets into technical motions, where we're talking about molar technique or whatever to pull off the pattern. Because if I was just playing this, not much vibe there, but that's not what I'm playing. What I'm playing is a shoulder and two tips, so it ends up being this, right?
Yeah. Much more difficult, probably.
It is a little more difficult if you're not used to doing it. But the point is that you, it becomes a motion thing, you know, for the drummers again, that it's a shoulder with the molar coming up for the tips, and then it becomes a consistent motion. I always say consistency of motion is the key to consistency of groove and feel, right? So when you're doing that, you know, and I chose to play that anticipation because either the melody or the piano does it. Now, we talked about this a little bit beforehand. There's some inconsistencies here in the parts being played that I had to memorize. I had to, because you gave me a chart, but by then I had played it so much that I memorized it. So, but certain things kept fooling me. Mm. Like going back to the head, for example, the first time. You know, this particular thing, for example. Right, that is an anticipation the first time. The second time, it's not. So those kind of things, you know, for me, those are the details that are important that I try to suss out, because how we treat that as drummers, you know, has everything to do with the feel. Now, when I do it, I don't think the bass is doing it. I think the bass is still, you know, either playing, might be going back to the...
He goes, do-do-do-do, do-do.
There you go. So because his part is one boudet coming back to the melody.
Right.
Yeah. So are
you playing that with the kick, by the way?
No, I was just gonna talk about that. I'm not. I'm actually, this is part of the whole thing of deciding, like, how many risks do you want to take with flams, with bass and bass drums?
Right.
And also it comes into a whole thing of, is the groove sitting? And this becomes a counterpoint aspect that I like to do sometimes. So mm-hmm. I was choosing to play the downbeat of the bass drum. Mm-hmm. And to me, it kind of works because it lets the bass and the piano counter off that downbeat. Check it out.
Yeah.
Wrong. Yeah, also there, these kind of things are important to me about what I do with the fill, because the melody is going bop bada, right? It's playing mm-hmm. the quarter note. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to do something that would step on that. And so what I'm playing is gadat boom bing, right? I'm playing something that goes to me with the music, rather than playing something that would be too busy or convoluted or even distract from the melody.
Yeah.
You know, and later on, there's another melody aspect that is important, you know, for me. So that I also play the part. I can't remember exactly where it is.
I really dig that bass drum on one and leave the rest of the bar completely.
Yeah. So, you know, now if I, this particular section, I don't know if I would play so differently. Mm-hmm. When we're talking about commercial approach versus fusion approach, because it, you know, there's not a lot going on here. There's not a lot to do that would constitute something musically supportive that would be busier versus not busier.
Sure.
But the biggest thing for me, I'm just going to do a little demonstration here, because especially in the chorus, mm-hmm. when I go to the hi-hat and mm-hmm. the snare drum, my main concern is consistency of sound with the snare, all right? And again, this becomes a technical thing, and I'm hitting rim shots, okay? And I'm hitting it, I'm cracking it pretty good. So the vibe is this. Right. So when I'm doing that groove, there's a couple things that I'm paying attention to. One of them, like I said, consistency of the backbeat. The other one is the bass drum pattern. And that one is sort of up for grabs because there's right. so many 16ths going on, right? There's 16ths happening in the bass part. So again, this becomes a thing where you can sing the parts, you know, it's boom, when that chorus kicks in. Yeah, there's so much going on. The piano is doing a lot of hits, you know, anticipating in different places. Right. So in these kind of situations, the safe thing to do is less. Less actually becomes more. You know, you could get away with simply this. Right? And sometimes that creates the vibe because it's so simple and it's repetitive mm-hmm. and it lets everybody else's part come through where there's not all this other drum stuff going on, you know. Now yeah. by the same token, I could get a lot busier and play if the for example, it's like if you would say, you know, it's a little too straight, a little too commercial, whatever, mm-hmm. you know, then I could go, you know, this vibe too.
That's cool.
Yeah. Well, see, you know, you're a jazzer, so you yeah. like, you know, so, and this is what I mean about giving the composer mm-hmm. choices, because just to give them one choice is, you know, it's not a lot to go by.
Sure.
But for me, it's like I can wear the hat or play the role. It's mm-hmm. it's almost role playing. It's like,
sure.
okay, am I supposed to be a studio drummer here that is just going to lay down, you know, that, mm-hmm. or is it, do we want more dialogue with all the parts going on and make it more interesting and popping and, you know, more jazz like to, cause I really wasn't playing a consistent part with the foot, especially with the bass sure. drum. I was playing sure. all this stuff, but your parts weren't consistent either. The piano was jabbing, not in consistent places.
Oh, totally. Was on yeah. yeah.
Yeah. So I'm also playing off of that. And in a sense, it's more of a dialogue approach.
It's more, it's more in the intended realm that way as a jazz dialogue kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. So, but it creates a vibe, you know, it creates, and there's different, it's a different effect, you know, for the music. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, sometimes it is important to have that defined before you play, because I know for me back in the day when I was doing, excuse me, lots of records in New York, mm-hmm. Man, there's, you know, during the GRP days, everybody had a record deal and I was doing five records a week, man. We were, you know, we'd go in and record 10 tunes in a day, you know, and before I went in, it was in that period. It was right kind of like as the transition of fusion and jazz was going to smooth jazz. And I'm like, what are we doing here? What is the, you know,
sure.
what is the concept? Is this supposed to be a jazz record or am I supposed to groove? You know? So I always have to get that defined before I would play anything. Because here's what happens, drummers. This is what happens. If you're not sure of what to do, you play with this intimidation. And then it affects your time. It affects your feel. And generally, you slow down. You know, at least me, I know that I tend to drag the tempo, or sometimes the opposite can happen too, because you're wanting to make it exciting, and you know, so you're jumping on the time. So all of those factors have to be, you know, paid attention to as to where the feel of the song should be. Should it be back a little bit and sitting, or should it have that excitement of more of a dialogue thing?
Yeah.
You know, the jazz thing. So that's kind of those approaches.
Playing solos to a quantized track and you know, with a click and stuff is always a little bit challenging, because you really have to sit right in the pocket, but at the same time you want to create that forward momentum. So it's like this little sort of balancing act, you know. Because me, when I put more energy into something, I tend to speed up. You know,
don't we all?
Yeah. So it's just like I really, really have to pay attention to what I'm doing, actually, you know, not just what everybody else is doing, but I really have to pay attention to what I'm doing, because if I just start listening and sort of jam with everybody, I do that too. But if I'm not really concentrating on what I'm doing, it sounds kind of obvious, but I don't think that we do that sometimes.
It's you know, especially in this day where the pandemic has kind of forced us all into our basements and mm-hmm. and we're recording everything remote. I mean, I, you know, before the pandemic, I was doing a ton of recordings remotely, because it's obviously sometimes not possible for everybody to get in the room. Sometimes it's
more
not
economical
even,
and all that. Shit.
Well, sometimes it's not even the best approach. I mean, unless I've always said, look, you know, unless you're a band or unless you have, you know, adequate time to rehearse, it almost doesn't matter, because 9 times out of 10, at least in situations I've been in,
they,
it's like, oh, let's play.
Anyway.
Say again?
They replace everything anyway.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, okay, let's all get in a room and play, and the drummer has to get the part right, and then everybody else is, oh, I'll just go fix my stuff. And it's like, wait a minute, man. Because then it's like, you know, you might as well just do it remotely and let the drummer. This is why when I'm doing... when I'm doing a track for somebody, I'm a real stickler about how the track is prepared, because, as you know, if there's all this stuff going on with different time feels, and I've said this before in these hangs, I don't know which one to choose, and it makes me feel like this the whole time, because I'm so hypersensitive to this because of my training with Jay Oliver back in the day, back in, you know, in the early mid 80s when Lynn drum machines were taking over the drummer's roles. You either had to play like and sound like a machine, or they just did it with the machine. So,
right.
So I did a lot of practicing to be precise with the rhythm. And when I started doing a lot of stuff with my buddy Jay Oliver here, we used to use, you know, a dedicated sequencer. I think, I don't remember the name of it, but it was a Yamaha piece of equipment. And we used the sequencer, and we triggered all FM sounds, right? So they were all modules. And so there was no delay, nothing.
Right.
Then all of a sudden, samples started to be the thing. Oh, it's a real instrument. You know, acoustic bass is the worst, you know, because it's like, you know. So the samples are always late, you know. So I get the bass parts, and I'm like, wait a minute, the click is here, and the bass is over here. What am I supposed to play with? And it's all being replaced anyway. So it's like... I just say, look, you got to get these things on the grid. Let me create the feel, and then you guys play to me. So that usually works out well. Okay. Hey, I see a question here. I see a question by Kyle. He said matched grip because of the alternate 16th groove. You know, this, I just had a student that was pretty interesting, because he sent me some videos. And you know, most match grip players, when they do a cross stick, they play it like this. And this is some drummer stuff, Gary. Give me 2 seconds here.
No worries,
but,
go.
But it's an important aspect. You know, because sometimes the drummers will they'll play, you know, the cross stick with the tip side, and generally speaking, that's always a kind of a thin sound, but it was kind of funny because the guy that sent me the video, he was playing traditional and then he went to matched and then he went back to this way. So there was all this confusion about how to hold a stick and which end. If you notice the guys that play traditional, Gad, myself, Vinny, whoever might play traditional, most of the time you're going to notice the butt end of the stick is being played from matched. That's because, first of all, it's very easy to go back and forth to make this transition. Second of all, the cross stick sounds better, okay?
Oh, yeah. Huge difference.
Yeah, I mean, I can kind of get up more on the stick. It's just a different sound. And so generally speaking, there's that when I'm either doing Latin stuff or this cross stick stuff, sometimes I won't change. I'll just keep this going for the consistency because there's no reason to change, especially if I'm playing a right hand backbeat. So this allows me to stay consistent and then I can go back to the cross stick. Now in the tenor solo, I decided to go to my comfort zone because I was playing some other stuff. But you'll see, so let me just play a little bit of the tenor solo here because I keep the pattern the same. And again, there's a lot of ways to approach the solo too. I could change up the groove a lot, but for me it wasn't working to lose the offbeat eighth part. So I was playing it either this way or I was playing the 16ths, but I did change. But when I go back to the cross stick, and this is about thinking about this, and this is part of the memorization of the tune, because it kept catching me off guard. We're going back to that intro, and I'm playing this, and then all of a sudden I had to get back to the cross stick. And if I didn't think about it right before to change, then there was a glitch in the time. So the tenor solo, let's see where we're at here. I think we're right here. That was that melody I was talking about too, ba-da-da, right, ba-da-da. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna play that as well instead of playing something else. It doesn't go with the melody. Mm-hmm. Anyway, back to the part about the groove aspect. So I started off playing not the hi-hat part, right? I went to here, but for me, I don't know about you, Gary, what did you think? Did it make a difference, you know, behind your tenor solo?
I don't even know what you changed, man. I'm sorry.
Okay. I started by doing this.
Okay. Then I went to this. Yeah. I like the first one, actually.
Yeah, so it does change. It changes mm-hmm. up kind of the vibe, but it does keep the offbeat going.
Yeah.
For a while, I was just playing straight, which I could do too. I could do that.
Thank you.
You sound so great on this, man.
It's
great.
Thanks.
always fun to play behind you. It's wonderful. So, but anyway, that can work too.
Yeah. I like the first one of the last demonstration segments.
Yeah.
I think that's
so that. Great. So that is this.
Yeah.
So that's that change that I'm talking about, drummers, to get back to the cross stick. If you're a traditional player, you know, I want to make sure that I'm not distracting myself or the time field by going too late back to the match.
Wow, we're 47 minutes already. Holy cow.
Yeah, I know. It's quick. Hey, Steve, is there any questions in there that you see? Let's see. That's funny. I always wonder if guys at Dave's level ever just call up some friends to hang out and just play music for fun. Yes, actually, we do. Yeah. Yeah, Ice Tech 6.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for the question. Sometimes we just, you know, go over to Jay's house. You know, now that I'm back in St. Louis here, we all get together with our friends and just play. It's just for fun, you know, and that's enjoyable as well. So no, it's not always work, but I will confess, most of the time it kind of is. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But okay.
Oh, look at that.
Hey,
there we go.
Hey,
I was Gary Meek for a second.
How did it feel?
I was a much better musician for that much. Yeah, there's some great questions and comments in here. I was wondering if maybe Gary wanted to talk a little bit about his do's and don'ts for drummers, being that he's a composer.
I meant to ask, pianist,
sax player, you know, mm-hmm. you kind of do it all.
Well, I would never have to say anything to Dave, not that I probably would anyway, because the main thing I want a drummer to be is supportive and not steering me in any direction that I don't want to go. Like, I don't like mimicry or chasing. That drives me nuts.
Yeah, we should talk about what that actually means, because I hear a lot of drummers do that. You know, so explain what you mean by that, Gary.
If I happen to like go into a triplet thing for like a second, you know, and the drummer goes right after, you know, or if we're swinging, if we're playing jazz, and you know, I go into, you know, the drummer goes ding 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 ding, like for like a couple of. For like a few bars or something. It's just like, holy shit, man, why are you doing that? I just did that. Why are you doing it?
Right.
You know, right. So it's like, and to some, you know, I've got the drummers around here pretty trained now. They won't do that. They won't do that with me because I have no problem saying, don't do that.
Right.
And, you know, The guys that I work with most, you know, Skyler and Andy Weiss over at the Spanish Bay, he loves it when I tell him things. Please tell me, you know.
Right.
And
that's the only way to learn. I mean, I remember when I was young and in New York, I would just ask all kinds of questions. Man, does this feel okay? Am I doing this right? What's it, you know? Tell me everything that's wrong.
Oh, I do that too. You know, that doesn't feel right to me. Am I behind or am I ahead? You know, what's going on? You know.
Right.
Because if I can't tell, then I hope somebody else can, you know. But, yeah, so that's the main thing. is just, and also I can't stand when I feel like the drummer isn't listening to me.
Right.
You know, right. like they're off in their own little world, you know, doing what
but
they,
wait, but wait, what does that mean exactly? Because if there's a, you know, some people could say, well, if I'm not going to copy you, or if I'm not going to just play off of what you did, I'm listening to you, mm-hmm. but you don't like that. So what do you mean by listening to me? What
does that mean? Yeah, I mean playing to the music that's there in the right way. And I don't know how else to say it other than that. You know, like when you're having a conversation with somebody, you don't just repeat what they say back, you know.
Right.
You keep the conversation going in the vein that it's in, you know. Now, you know, a lot of guys try to catch everything you do, you know. They try to catch every single thing you do, and that's only cool if it's exactly right, you know. And it's just kind of most people aren't exactly technically accurate. So just kind of, you know, open your ears and feel what the music is saying that should be done. You know, it's I don't know how else to describe it, but that's kind of, you know, that's kind of what we all need to do. Saxophone players do it too, you know. Mm-hmm. Like I hear saxophone players like putting in fills and stuff, playing behind singers, and it's just like, shut up.
Yeah. Well, the one thing that you're very good at is, you know, I call it creating space instead of leaving space. So, so you allow, you know, the dialogue to happen, and that's kind of what it is. Now we're sort of talking in a jazz sensibility here, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Because in a contemporary sense, if there's a singer, or again, if it's supposed to be a more commercial thing, it's like, drummers are, you know, pretty much, you know, expected to play less. They're not, you know, really not supposed to overplay the situation.
Well, it's about understanding your role. That's right. What it is, you know, yeah. Because, you know, all the best musicians in general, you know, understand their role. And the better you can make the music that you are playing speak and work, the better it looks for everybody.
Yeah. Well, there's so much that goes into that, though, because there's, mm-hmm. you know, it's not only about, you know, the drummer and the soloist, and there's a whole rhythm section thing going on.
Absolutely.
So, and this was, you know, probably made most apparent to me from listening to Chick Corea, mm-hmm. and playing with him, of course, in all those years. And he was very specific about telling the soloist, hey, this is not just your solo.
Mm-hmm.
It's a dialogue, you know, and if you listen to any Chick record, you know, going back to, you know, his beginning stuff, I mean, there, the comp and what was going on behind the solo was almost as important as the solo, and it became that dialogue. So it's not just about the drummer, you know, paying attention to the soloist. It's also what's going on with the bass player, the keyboard player, guitar player, whatever it is. So that, again, the drummer has to back off and not play so much so that the other parts can come through.
Absolutely. One thing I wanted to say about the listening thing, and that one thing that drives me crazy is when the drummer suddenly drops the dynamic level, like, you know, to soft, just out of the blue.
In the middle of your solo.
In the middle of my solo, yeah.
Yeah, that's a no-no.
Yeah, it's like, you're not listening to me. You know what I mean? You're not you're not listening to what I'm saying, because I'm not saying to get soft. and you know, it's kind of like, you know, how do you say that other than just say, you know, I like my dynamic level to be a certain way, and generally, if you're listening to me, I don't think you've ever had any trouble determining where I'm going. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, but that's one thing that drives me crazy, and more than a few drummers do that. You know?
Yeah.
I'm going to change. Yeah, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's really about the support, which I talk about all the time. Is you know, it's that. It's the atmosphere you create, and it's like if you do that, you know, you change the dynamic or the, you know, the other thing that drives me crazy listening, you know, to another drummer is if they change the texture also, which has to do with the dynamic.
Right.
You know, it's like you're playing the ride and you're up there and then all of a sudden you get quieter and you go to the hi-hat.
Right.
When it's supposed to be going, you know, forward and up. So
why? Yeah. Why did you do that?
Right. Right. And I think it's generally because they're not listening, and there's a disconnect between what they're doing as drummers and how they're actually supporting to the music. So I think the takeaway of this is another thing that I like to say a lot, is that try to be conscious of listening to yourself within the music, like you're listening back to yourself playing or somebody else.
Exactly.
How would you want this texture to go? Don't get so entrapped in your own self and your own stuff. It's always, especially when you're playing with other musicians, man, it's all about the dynamic context. It's all about the support that you're giving from an ethereal aspect of cymbals, you know, the sustain factor versus a not sustain factor. And it's, again, it's about the dynamic, you know, the contrast, and also the dynamic level that you're, you know, playing behind someone. And all those things are kind of rules of the band that have to be either discussed, rehearsed, or, you know, or you really got to be listening, even in a jam session, you know, sensibility. And talking mostly about the drummer, but it's also not only the drummer. I mean, bass players, too, can really ruin that whole vibe by pushing the envelope or not playing loud enough in situations. So it's always a band thing, and it's always about listening to how the greats have done it in the past, you know, with the support and the playing and all kinds of styles. And then it becomes a thing of how you want to sound, how you want to play, and then the rules of the band that you and the people that you're playing with at the moment, of how you want to support them and how they like to be supported. And that can be discussion too. That can be something that you talk about, right?
The only band that I have ever been in that never talked about that was the acoustic band.
Our acoustic group. Yeah.
Yeah. We never had to discuss it. It was just,
no. Everybody had such big ears with Makoto, Ozone, and Tom Kennedy. Yeah, that was a great band for sure. All right, so Steve, you got a deadline today. Is that correct?
I do, but you know, I want to ask Gary, there are a lot of questions here about where do I find this song, where do I find your music, that kind of thing. What is the best way to discover Gary Meek's music?
Well, you can buy my last few CDs on my website. There's a CD store there. And I'm also on Spotify and Apple Music and all that shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
Oh, sorry, I'm not supposed to say.
Okay, these are drummers.
No. All your favorite streaming platforms. Yeah.
Hey, somebody asked me if I'm friends with Gary Novak. Yeah, for a long time. I've known Gary since he was a teenager. So.
He's
one of the greatest players out there. I love Gary. He's great. Terrific. I guess we are out of time. Should I play the whole song? Is that something I can do? Do we have time to do that?
Absolutely. Let's
do
that.
Yeah, so you can hear, because Gary's playing flute, he's playing tenor, and, you know, again, it's about the treatment of the song anyway.
Man, we should do a part two, man. This went way too fast.
We should do that.
See this become part of the school, maybe a play along or something like that. I saw some people asking about that, if that's possible. So what a tune.
That's going to be up to Gary, because you know, maybe if we only release it in the school, it would be something to do, you know.
Yeah.
And we can talk about it for sure. I mean, shit, like, how do you not want Dave to play on your stuff?
That's great. All right, so we kind of are out of time today, and I appreciate you all being here, and I hope you enjoyed it. It's everything Gary said was really, really nice to hear, and you know, like I said, bro, you're one of my favorites. You're a killer musician, and thanks for the inspiration and the sounds. And
likewise, man, I miss you a lot.
Yeah. Well, we'll do some more stuff. Don't worry. That's we have a record too. My latest thing is the my band live at the Chesterfield Jazz Festival that is released, that's out there, and that was a great live show that we did here in St. Louis couple years ago, and that that was just released a few months ago on Autumn Hill Records. And your record's on Autumn Hill Records too.
That's right. We are label mates.
Yeah, label mates. Yeah, but yeah, we want
to. That live record streaming everywhere, so anyone wants to hear it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we want to thank the Silverman Brothers for really supporting us and live music in general and recordings with Autumn Hill Records. And this is where I'm still at here at Autumn Hill Recording Studios while mine is getting built. So anyway, let me play the whole tune, Struck by Lightning, and wish you all well, and we'll see you next time. Hopefully we'll see some of you out there on tour too. European tour with me and Tom Kennedy as a co-led band, playing some music from Stories, which Gary is on as well. That's another great record. So we hope to see you out there. All right, everybody be well. Gary, well, thank you so much, man.
Dude. Oh, man, my pleasure. My pleasure.
They're going to hear all, and Gary's playing keyboards on this song too, just so you know. Okay, cool. Here's Struck by Lightning. Yeah. All right, let me put this guy on. Turn this off. All righty. That was a bunch of fun. Struck by Lightning, Gary Meek. I want to thank you all for coming in again and hanging out on the hang with us here. And be well, be safe. We'll see you next time. Thanks so much. Ciao.